for a show that includes so much murder, amputation, rape, backstabbing, and accounting, Black Sails sure had some audacity to be about love and the power of friendship in the end. Black Sails is a prequel to the Victorian novel Treasure Island, a book which I have not read and will not read. What do I look like, a 14-year-old Victorian boy? Really? Oh. Stop. This is kind of a bizarre show, and while I do love it a lot, I won't pretend it doesn't have any writing problems. I love a show that doesn't overstay its welcome. Concise storytelling keeps writers on track toward a satisfying goal. Too much time can also mean too many distractions and too many loose ends to try to tie together. But there is such a thing as moving too fast, and Black Sails cuts it close sometimes. There are times when watching a relationship develop in Black Sails feels a bit like watching a failing marriage on Facebook. You don't get that slow, easy progression, but you can see all the moments that count. I think growing up on Avatar The Last Airbender really gave me unreasonable expectations on how it should feel for a character dynamic to unravel throughout the course of a show. In just 3 seasons of 22-minute episodes, I felt like I knew these characters better than my own mind, and the relationships that had formed and changed between them felt inescapably real. I don't feel like I was told a single thing about a relationship in Avatar that I didn't see for myself. Except, you know, one. Relationships in Black Sails morph and fluctuate rapidly, and it's often difficult to pinpoint exactly how a character feels. But the show also has a sneaky way of simulating deeper relationships while keeping the more mundane political connections of the show nimble and changeable. The writers tend to pile on layers of affection, allegiance, relationships of convenience, one on top of another, simply allowing the many facets of each relationship to coexist as though they were singular. For instance, there's no such thing in Black Sails as loving someone for their money. Loving someone is loving someone, and Black Sails tends to honor all forms of love almost indiscriminately. This ends up being a really poignant theme, considering all the queer stuff. That's actually a big part of why you're watching this video, right? Like, if you're looking for a Black Sails video in 2023, it's probably because you were really moved by the way it handles its same-gender relationships. The romances of the queer characters are not pushed to the periphery, they're front and center, they're the meat of the show. The central conflict of the show culminates in a revelation that a gay love is just as meaningful as a straight love.
When I thought Marty was gone, I saw, for the first time, I saw the world through your eyes. A world in which there is nothing left to lose. I felt the need to make sense of the loss. To impart meaning to it. Whatever the cost. To exalt her memory with battles and victories.
Love in Black Sails has a very dreamy sort of quality. You're invited to always trust that each kind of love is exactly as genuine and sincere as it looks. The messed up, beautiful weirdness of the Max and Jack thing has a couple examples of relationships that should be built off of nothing but financial gain and political expediency that are revealed to be sincere. Not only that, but the lines between platonic and romantic love are shown to be kind of arbitrary. This is very present in the relationship between Flint and Silver, which is almost constantly in flux. Despite the fact that deception is a running motif throughout the show, characters don't really try to deceive each other about the nature of their feelings. They may not totally understand how they feel, like Eleanor for Vane or Anne for Max, but they don't actively obfuscate it. On first viewing, the character of John Silver was deeply strange to me. Somewhere between the middle and the end of season 2, he undergoes a full metamorphosis from a selfish bastard to a self-sacrificing leader, and that didn't make any sense to me. What happened between him choosing to betray Flint and choosing to sacrifice his leg to keep his crew safe? And it looks to me like there's only one answer. Flint did.
Those men listen to you. They give a shit about what you have to say, what you think, what you want them to think. Where else in the world is that true? Where else would you wake up in the morning and matter?
Which, logically, doesn't make a lot of sense. because this comment by Flint is exactly what precipitates John running off to coordinate stealing the Arcadelema gold away from Flint. So this is it, right? John had a choice to make. Stay in place where he had a role to play in the success of the many, or wander off to seek a lonesome life of stealing for his supper. Except, no. Silver makes his choice, but it doesn't lock him into a path long-term. Instead, he slumps off to secure his solitary prize, only to be dragged back onto the track Flint led him toward. He embraces his utility to the crew, and realizes how good it feels to be needed and genuinely loved. I think this is so weird. Silver's relationship to Flint is what brings on this change, but Silver's feelings toward him do nothing but go from purely indifferent to ambiguously hateful. We take it for granted that Silver just considers Flint his meal ticket in the first half of the show. But in the beginning of season 2, Silver actually wants to escape the punishment of the crew by fleeing with Flint, without the gold. Silver could have pinned everything on Flint, stayed with the crew, and gotten his share of the plunder. For all the greed and indifference he exhibits throughout the first and second season, these two have a sort of inexplicable bond right from the outset. And no, I'm not shipping them. Let's just get that out of the way up front. Technically, the Walrus is shipping them, but that ended up being a crack ship. But, ow. I would not survive on a pirate ship. Not without my coffee, am I right, ladies? This relationship has a lot more in common with a father-son dynamic, although it's not the kind of father-son dynamic you're probably thinking of. Throughout the show, Flint is compared to a god, and let's just get the obvious out of the way and say that John Silver is pretty clearly a Jesus analog. This running allusion to Flint and Silver being this dark father and son duo is very compelling to me. It reminds us that these people are ultimately not driven by wealth and power. It's ideas, love, and visions of the future that make them so much more powerful than the petty politicians they're surrounded by. For Flint, it's suggested that he literally manifests his will through nature due to his sheer commitment to his goals. He sets his mind to an impossible task and just does it. His main issue is that he acts like a visionary, but he has no real vision of his own. His partnership with Thomas Hamilton is noted by Miranda to be so powerful because Thomas had these big visions of the future, and James had the power to force them into actualization. Without Thomas, Flint defaults to a watered-down and ultimately meaningless version of his goals. Thomas's plan for Nassau was to reform the pirates and make them law-abiding, tax-paying citizens that can contribute to the economy. Without that ideal to anchor down his actions, Flint defaults to wanting to make an autonomous state that can bring the British Empire to its knees.
Good luck!
Flint doesn't even particularly care about democracy. He wants to be a king, to have power over people. Hardly a radical idea. Speaking of democracy or lack thereof, have you noticed that Black Sails tends to just generally hate people?
You were just here 2 days ago.
Yes.
To withdraw 500 pieces. It was dispersed, was it not?
Yes.
But you're back for more.
Yes.
What in God's name did you spend 500 pieces on in 2 days' time?
I lost it.
I feel like we all went through this phase where we were like, oh yeah, pirates are so cool because they're like a semi-democratic way of organizing labor. And Black Sails was like, yeah, that wasn't a good thing. Granted, there is no democracy where there is coercion, and piracy involves a lot of coercion. But internally, they sort of operate as an autonomous collective. Flint's allusion to wanting to usher in a monarchy feels dangerous. Like, this guy wants to stop the only cool thing about piracy, which is their egalitarian form of organizing labor. To any prospective employers watching this, please hire me. I promise I won't unionize to protect my rights. In the absence of his better half, Flint is just kind of a tyrant. Without money, even with his incredible ability to rally support, he has to use the generic promise of wealth to keep his crew fighting for him. And he knows this, which is why he's sensitive to the powerful relationship between Maddie and John, even assuming all on his own that Maddie will take his place in their dynamic duo. Of the three of them, Maddie is the real visionary. She condones Flint's methods when extreme, but for reasons that go beyond power. Of the three of them, Maddie is the real visionary, condoning Flint's methods when extreme, but for reasons that go beyond seizing power or getting revenge.
The voice you hear in your head. I imagine I know who it sounds like, as I know Eleanor wanted those things. But I hear other voices. A chorus of voices. Multitudes. They reach back centuries. Men and women and children who lost their lives to men like you. Men and women and children forced to wear your chains. I must answer to them. And this war, their war, Flint's war, my war, it will not be bargained away to avoid a fight, to save John Silver's life, or his men's, or mine.
James's love for Thomas is a yin that needs a yang, and the dynamic of that relationship is made profound through this analogy to God. Especially because, for people familiar with Treasure Island, or have just watched Treasure Planet like me, Flint is this mysterious, primordial figure in comparison to Silver, who is physically in the book. The first time we see Flint in black sails, his face is almost completely veiled, like the face of a being that watches but does not reveal itself to humanity. I just think black sails does a good job with his aesthetic generally. Like, the shot of him and Hamilton kissing has this dense shadow covering their faces, and it makes this scene feel like it's happening in a world separate from ours, or in some mysterious time in the past. This love is the core of the show. The influence of this mostly invisible Thomas Hamilton guy is important. As for John, as a the sun allegory, his place in the story is a lot more aligned with normal everyday interactions, whereas Flint brings this intensity to every moment he's in. Silver is working with the day-to-day activities of surviving, getting people to like him, and indulging in his interest in compulsively stealing things. He gets lost in the mundane stuff, and on the second viewing I found that he was nowhere near as cynical as I initially thought. It's clear that he kind of believes his own bullshit. He's regularly shocked when his predictions and overtures at charm and charisma fall flat.
How dangerous can he be?
I see him now as more of a well-meaning nuisance, at least in the early seasons. He gets so distracted by tedious minutiae that he doesn't have time for the big, imposing goals that dominate Flint's life. Silver isn't a psychopath. He isn't particularly nice, but he takes a genuine interest in people that manifests in an uncanny ability to discover and abuse what they really want. This curiosity and inability to keep his nose out of anyone else's business is sometimes really useful, but these skills don't really help him focus on any larger goals other than surviving. He has a general sense, like Flint, that he would like to walk away from the violent and scary world that he's become entangled in, but he can't, because he has no money and he refuses to work for exploitative capitalists. Is there a socialist message in black sails? Who can say? More like black and red sails, am I right, comrades? I think Flint offers Silver a new way of living his life and seeking meaning. While John can manipulate what people want, Flint has this incredible power to create desires in people. In fact, we can probably extrapolate that he's been planting a seed in Eleanor's head from the beginning that Nassau could be an autonomous state. Flint's charisma isn't charming, it's a terrifying force, born not out of malice, but really out of a desperate love that was taken away from him. He was a strident pragmatist that fell head over heels for a lofty idealist. The synthesis of these character traits is frighteningly effective, but Flint is so far out of what other people can grasp that he kind of hates them. He thinks they're beneath him. That's why Silver's endless need to understand people is such a valuable asset to Flint. He comes to see how powerful Silver can be when he has an endgame in mind. Protect the crew, get the gold, save Mahdi. I think Flint's influence on Silver is the main force behind the action of the show. And while Silver succeeds in getting what he wants in the end, a peaceful life free of political intrigue, Flint has a far more fundamental victory over Silver, though he didn't intend to. Silver enters into his own relationship that goes beyond a typical romantic couple. He and Mahdi are an ideological unit, held together by forces outside their control. A pairing between a pragmatist and an idealist, like James and Thomas. Together, they beat any other motivation, good or bad. Black Sails does have an ambiguously bad ending. Nassau is completely corrupt, with only the intentions of a few sort of nice people to guide it toward better days. But love does win out, right or wrong. Really, it's Flint's need to reinvent the world through strength that gets subverted. His idea that wrangling this mass of hardened, marginalized people into a kingdom for him to rule is the actual issue. Flint is not only compared to a god, he seems to believe the hype himself. He dominates, which is something that he does really naturally. His instinct to wage war on civilized society is something he falls back on, not an active choice to make the world a place where boys can kiss boys without consequences. It's also Silver's love for Flint that keeps him alive long enough to see Thomas Hamilton again.
But I will stand here with you. For an hour. A day, a year. Will you find a way to accept this outcome? So that we might leave here together.
Despite the absolute hatred these two have had for each other at different points, Flint's sincerity ultimately won Silver over. The fact that he genuinely cared about Mahdi and thought her leadership could make Nassau a better place. In the end of the show, ideas and visions of the future are exposed to be ultimately weak, whereas love is a tangible force that shapes the world.
All this will be for nothing. We will have been for nothing. Defined by their histories. Distorted to fit into their narrative. Until all that is left of us are the monsters in the stories they tell their children. I don't care.
I don't know how I feel about the ending of Black Sails, and I've been sitting on this question for over a year now. I feel like the show lured me in with these big ideas about egalitarianism and liberation from oppressive hierarchies, and it left me with this little sting at being told that I shouldn't care too much about those things. And yet, these big ideas about what a just society should look like are the backbone of two of three of the core relationships of the show. I guess I don't know what drives a society forward. The conclusion that Black Sails comes to feels inconclusive, but ultimately satisfying. Justice is an eternal process, and there are always going to be stalls in progress and setbacks. Individual happiness might seem selfish in a world that hasn't been perfected yet, but it's also the only thing one can feasibly win in their lifetime. So, get to it. Thank you for watching this video. Please engage with me in the comments. Like, comment, and subscribe, and share this on stuff, and check out my links in the description below. I love doing this, and I'm really glad that you guys are here with me. You guys are so lucky that you're seeing this makeup in a camera and not in a mirror, because your face would just dissolve instantly. Whereas on camera, it looks fucking sexy.